Hello there, I'm Peggy. Thank you for joining us today. And we're going to talk about good health, about what you do to get healthy or stay healthy. And it doesn't matter how old you are, we can all improve. And we have some experts here. And I'm really delighted and thank you for coming. Kendra Garrett is here. And Kendra, well, she makes her home here, but she's originally born in Indiana, and is a graduate of Ball State University, and she is a member of the American College of Sports Medicine, and you are a fitness specialist.
That's right.
Right?
Yes.
Okay, so you help people stay fit or get fit, whatever the need may be, and then Dane Smith is here, and they're both here on behalf, of course, of the Life Center, which is part of the Greenville Hospital. Am I right?
Yes, we're managed by Greenville Health System.
Yeah, and the health system. Okay, I want to be sure I had it all right. And you are a conditioning specialist.
Yes, ma'am.
Wow. Okay. And I think there are probably hundreds of us out there who need conditioning.
Yes, ma'am.
And they are going to demonstrate some exercises after a while, and some that for all ages.
Of course.
Yeah. Now tell me, before we get into that, the Life Center is more than just exercise. They have all kinds of programs there. Am I right?
That's right. The Life Center offers therapy programs. For example, we manage an oncology rehab program and a cardiac rehab program, as well as a pulmonary rehab program. And we offer water aerobics and arthritis aquatics programs. But in addition to our exercise programs, we also have education opportunities. We offer smoking cessation.
You just made my day. So you help people who have been addicted just cancel all that out.
That's right. And part of the smoking cessation program is a support group opportunity, because people are more successful when they are in groups. So, you know, part of that is education and training, and then part of it is the support that comes from other people who are going through the same situation and experts who can help with that.
So you have a full program.
We do.
For all age groups. And you do have lectures on nutrition and that sort of thing as well, don't you?
We do. We have registered dietitians who often do education sessions about eating more vegetarian or incorporating just basic healthy choices in your meal planning. We do grocery shopping tours, which
You're
are
kidding.
Kind of exciting. Yeah, they'll go to the grocery store and kind of walk the aisles with you and teach you how to make healthier choices.
And read those labels?
Reading labels. They're overwhelming.
Yeah, with all the stuff. And if it has something on there I can't pronounce, I put it back.
That might be an okay idea.
So now tell me about being a conditioning specialist. What do you do?
I work in the different programs that Kendra talked about, with the oncology rehab and the heart life and the pulmonary rehabs and things like that. And then also we do personal training, and we also do, like, if you were to just come and join Peggy and you just felt like, okay, I need to step up my fitness, I need some help, I need to bring it along slow, I need somebody to show me how to do that, that's what I do.
Now, if somebody, and we're going to see what you do in a minute, but if somebody out there thinks, oh, I need to get back, I need to exercise, and maybe they haven't exercised for years.
Yes, ma'am.
You don't just all of a sudden go out.
No matter.
How do you help people?
We bring them along slowly. We do it by step-by-step process, and we're available. We set up appointments on a bi-weekly basis to bring them back in and check on their progress and go from there.
But, I mean, it can be dangerous if you have not exercised forever, and then all of a sudden you think, oh, I've got to get into this, and you go at it right away. You need to, just like a child learning to walk.
I mean, your body's not used to that because you hadn't been doing it. So, yes, ma'am, you need to get some advice and get some expert help and go from there.
And people of all age groups.
Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am. We work with kids. We have a We have a strong kids program that we bring in kids anywhere from 10 to 13 years old. And then we have a senior program like with the HeartLife patients. Some of those patients, after they get done with HeartLife, which is our cardiac rehab program, they join the Life Center, the club, and then they come to us and we're available to them as well. So it's an ongoing process for those guys.
Now you have aerobics, water aerobics.
Yes,
you have special expertise in that.
Yes. I manage the group fitness and the aquatics programs, and we offer about 20 water aerobics classes a week throughout the week in the mornings, in the evenings, and on the weekends. And the water aerobics classes are really inviting for new exercisers, exercisers who are carrying extra weight, and exercisers who have joint pain or discomfort because the water absorbs some of the impact and kind of cushions the joints so that you're able to exercise more comfortably where things would be uncomfortable on land.
Because it's easier, isn't it, to exercise in the water?
Easier is a tricky word, because you can get an excellent, you can feel challenged in the water, but it doesn't feel as uncomfortable or painful. So it can be more more joint friendly, so it feels easier.
Like somebody who suffered from arthritis.
Yes.
If they were to do exercises in the water, it would be more healing for them, wouldn't
it? Absolutely. That's one of our most highly attended classes, is our arthritis aquatics class. It's organized by, our instructors are trained by the Arthritis Foundation to teach water exercises specifically in an aquatic environment where we work range of motion and flexibility of the joints, where there are activities that you can do to strengthen and improve joint movement in the water that might otherwise not be okay out of the water.
And what is your advice to people who haven't been in the habit of exercising? Should they go and get a doctor, you know?
Yes, ma'am. A physician's referral.
Before they come,
yes,
or
ma'am.
What?
Yes, ma'am. We always recommend going seeing a doctor, get a referral from them to make sure everything's okay before you get started. Because, I mean, if you hadn't been active for a while, there may be things going on, issues going on within your body that you may not know about.
And see, it used to be that kids had PE in school and all that. They've kind of cut out all of that. And more people sit in front of the computer or the TV, and that can be dangerous.
We're not nearly as active as a society as we used to be. So where we used to be getting activity just naturally, children and adults, we're not doing that anymore. So we have to be more intentional about getting that physical activity. So that's where we come into play. It has to be structured and planned. We offer a lot of opportunities for that, but Dane's absolutely right. We recommend speaking to your doctor first, and most doctors will be excited that you want to exercise, but they might list a few things that would be better than others, and then they might give you some ideas on how to start slowly.
So you actually, or if somebody, for instance, has had a heart problem or a heart attack or whatever, and they come back, you're very mindful of what they need to do.
Yes, ma'am. They fill out a health history form with us, and we know all of their issues before we get started with anything.
Now, the Life Center is located off of, down at the Augusta Road.
That's right. The Life Center is right off of Ferris Road.
Across near the hospital.
Yeah, across from Greenville Memorial.
Yeah, so you're kind of all there together.
We are.
Yeah, and it is, you have to join the Life Center just like you join the Y or anything else, right?
That's right. You don't have to be a patient or an employee of the hospital system in order to join the Life Center, though. So it's a gym or a club membership, and there are opportunities. It's a monthly membership, but if somebody isn't sure about committing to a month, we can do single visit passes or
okay.
a temporary
and you can swim.
Pass. You can.
Okay.
You can swim.
All right. We are going to go to a break. And take a deep breath and get ready. They're going to show us all how to get fit. We'll be right back. Well, if you tuned in late, we're talking about getting fit, staying healthy, what you can do, and some of the things that we could even do at home. So we have two experts here from the Life Center, and we're so proud to be able to kind of watch all of this and take notes, and we can do it ourselves. So we're ready if you are, Kendra Garrett and Dane Smith from the Life Center.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, we're ready.
We're ready. One thing we can start out doing at home is a simple in and out of the chair. Standing up and down out of a chair will increase your leg strength, lower body strength, and that'll increase your mobility around the house and independence and getting around on your own. After a chair, if you want to get a little more advanced, you can use a ball from Target or Walmart, just like this. You can sit on the ball. Kendra's going to sit on the ball for us. While she's on the ball, we can use weights to improve upper body strength. Now, sitting on the ball, you wonder why sitting on the ball is better than sitting on the chair. The ball engages your core strength as well. Instead of just sitting in a chair, you can relax in a chair sitting on this ball. Kendra's abs are tight, her lower back's tight, holding her body upright in this position. Now, from here, we can do a number of things like a bicep curl. Kendra's going to demonstrate a bicep curl. This is going to increase our arm strength. She's also going to move into a shoulder press, which is going to increase the shoulder strength. All of us use our shoulders. I'm sure shoulder pain, shoulder mobility, something comes into play every day. So this could be helpful. She can do a lateral raise out to the side, just like that, nice and smooth. All of her movements are nice and smooth, nice and controlled. And those are some things you can do at home, pretty simple, easy, on a ball. If you feel like this isn't enough, you know, this is just getting started type deal, you want to do something, this is a place to start. After this, you can seek professional advice, and you can go from there. Now, Kendra's going to talk about some mobility issues, right. Stretching.
I'll show a few more exercises that we can do using the ball. So I'm going to set the weights down and show some ways that you can challenge flexibility and balance. I will mention that those exercises that we did with the weights, if we're not quite ready for the ball or we haven't bought our ball yet, those can happen from a chair too. You notice when I sat down on the ball, I brought my feet a little bit wider than my hips because that makes me a little bit more stable here. The closer my feet are together, the more wobbly I'm going to feel. So placing your feet in a different position will challenge your balance. And once you've managed that, you can begin to move one foot at a time, challenging your balance as you reposition yourself. So I'm still using my core, like Dane spoke about before, but I sometimes have one foot off of the floor. Now, if you want to try it, but you're not quite sure about being out in the open, you can always put the ball right next to a wall, put your hand up against a wall, and experiment there first. Some other things that we can do on the ball or in a chair for stretching and for range of motion are some spinal stretches. Since I'm on the ball, I'm going to stay here. But we can do a spinal twist. So I can just turn and look over my shoulder. And I'll do that in both directions. If I'm feeling pretty good about that, I can get my arms involved. So I'll bring one around and let my eyes follow it. And then come back around to the front and let my eyes follow the other direction. I call this checking the blind spot because when you're driving and you're changing lanes or you've got to see what's going on in the back seat, you still need that range of motion to turn and look. And if we don't keep that mobility, then sometimes those types of activities are the things that are challenged. So I call that one checking the blind spot. Some other stretches that I want to share are for our legs and our hips, and I want to do those from the chair. I'm going to put the ball there, hold it still with my weights. So, leg flexibility. We can do a hamstring stretch from here, and that's at the back of our legs. So if we sit nice and tall, straighten one leg, keep the other one bent, and then just lean out. I'm making sure that this knee isn't locked out. It's bent just a little bit, and I'm stretching in the back of my leg and in my low back. And then I'll do both sides. Another stretch that we can do for our hips, which often get tight and sometimes carry pain as a result, is a hip stretch. So we can take one leg, cross it over, And then just lean forward until we feel the stretch in the back of this hip. Sometimes you don't have to go very far to feel that stretch. Okay. And I would be sure to do that on both sides, holding each stretch about 10 seconds. Neck stretches are always important, so I showed that that checking the blind spot exercise, but we didn't talk about range of motion in the neck. That one's important too. So we can stretch our neck just by bringing an ear to a shoulder, using a hand for help, and then going to both sides. So Dane and I have demonstrated some strength exercises, some flexibility exercises, and some balance exercises. What we didn't talk about is cardiovascular exercise, and these are exercises that are anything that gets your heart rate up, like walking, riding a bicycle, anything that, swimming, aerobics we talked about earlier. Those are exercises that you'll want to include too that we weren't able to demonstrate today, but you'll want to do those most days of the week as well. So those are our demonstrations.
We're going to go to a quick break and come back, and we have more information for you. And these things, what I noticed is you do them with great ease. I mean, there's none of this jerking or rushing. It's all very easy. You make it seem easy.
Mm-hmm. Well, it might feel challenging, but you're absolutely right. We don't want to jerk or rush through our movements. We want to go slowly, take our time, and move through a range of motion that feels natural and not jerky. So it is an ease of movement that we're after, and we want it to be comfortable and natural.
You made it. Okay, we'll be back in just a moment. Well, are you inspired to get started? I was impressed with how gentle and graceful and easy that it seemed. And the word exercise kind of frightens many people. And it doesn't have to be that way. And Kendra Garrett and Dane Smith are the experts. But you made it seem almost, you know, artistic. It was, you know. And yet it's something we could, if we're sitting at home in front of the television, or, you know, you could do this.
Absolutely, Peggy, and that's kind of our hope for a demonstration like this, is that we could show that while exercise might require some work, it doesn't have to be overwhelming, and it doesn't have to be a whole lot in order to be beneficial, and you don't need a lot of equipment. So this is something that you can add to your seated routine at home.
I mean, you don't even have to spend money to join a club to exercise. These are simple things we can all do. Yeah, and you had this big ball, but you could easily do what you did just sitting in a chair.
That's right.
And this is for any age, I mean, a senior citizen.
Absolutely.
How important is it as we grow older, how important is it to keep moving?
It's very important. I mean, you have your lifestyle you're used to, and you don't want that to go anywhere. So if you become limited because of muscular strength or range of motion or mobility, there'll be issues that are going to limit your lifestyle and affect your mood and your happiness and your independence.
What about just walking? I mean, people used to walk, and now we don't bother anymore. If you're going to the grocery store, you try to find the spot to park your car that's closest to the door. Don't we all do that? Yeah.
Maybe.
And maybe if we parked way back and walked into the store, little things like that we could do.
You're right. We have made things so convenient and easy for ourselves that we don't have to work like we used to have to work. But our bodies need us to, in order to stay, like Dane said, in order for us to stay able to do the things that we need to and want to do, we have to keep moving. And so we have to make choices to park far away sometimes, even if the convenience factor is there. Maybe we can pass it up just for health's sake and walk a little bit farther.
Now, what about you work with even professional athletes?
Sometimes.
And you think they wouldn't need anybody.
I mean, everybody has questions, and everybody can benefit from a different point of view. So you can always get tips or advice or help from somebody else? Because it doesn't hurt to change it up every once in a while.
What does a professional trainer do? Because we always think of a movie star or somebody would have their own professional trainer. But you hear about it more and more.
A professional trainer, I feel like, is somebody that can take any situation and adapt their style to it. They can take a senior or an athlete or a child, and they can help with their personal goals. That's somebody that can be adaptive to each situation, because everybody's so different. Everybody that you see, everybody that needs help, everybody that has a question has a different question or needs different help, has a different situation.
So you work almost one-on-one with some people.
Yes, ma'am, we do. We work one-on-one with a lot of people, actually. And in fact, it boils down to everybody we work with is pretty much one-on-one, whether they're in a group setting or a class setting or anything. It's the attention. Everybody's so different. Everybody's needs are different. Everything we do is one-on-one, really.
Now, we have a phone number on the screen, and that is the Life Center here in Greenville. And I'm sure they would be glad to answer questions or whatever. But this is a part of our life that we have let slip, most of us, and we're all guilty. Yeah. So we need to get out there and walk. What about posture? You know, we kind of all forget about that too. You know, remember when your mother used to say, stand up straight, stand up straight.
Well, a lot of our activities that we do today, or our positions that we put ourselves in today, don't lend towards straight posture. If you think about the time that we spend at the computer, driving our car, cutting our meals, we're in this forward flex position all of the time. And so in order to strengthen those posture muscles and keep them strengthened, we've got to balance out with exercises that draw our posture muscles up. And we do that with some of the exercises that we showed today that require your core to get engaged and sit up nice and tall.
Now you, Kendra, you work a great deal of time with people who are coming back from cancer, who are trying to get well.
We have programs, yes ma'am, at the Life Center that work with people who are recovering from cancer.
And also heart disease?
Yes.
How important is it for somebody, you know, to keep your heart strong, to keep your heart, that the heart is a muscle.
It is a muscle, and it needs exercise. And so it's vital that we exercise it. So I'll say this, when people are recovering from a heart attack or a heart condition, once their physician has cleared them for exercise and has guided what their exercise program should look like, then we play a role that is a role of supervision, but also one of accountability, because like Dane said, sometimes people need guidance or advice, but sometimes people just need someone to make sure that they keep coming back, or someone who can listen when things are getting challenging. So that's another role that we play in these groups, is that that we can be listeners and we can be supporters when things start to feel discouraging.
I guess the truth of the matter is, if you're in a group and you're exercising, it becomes fun. It becomes, otherwise it can be a drudgery and think, oh, I've got to exercise today. And if people get into it, it becomes an enjoyable experience.
Absolutely. You build relationships when you do these things in groups. So not only are we building relationships with the exercise professionals, but also the other members or students in the classes that are coming at the same time, you make friends, and then your friends wonder where you are if you don't come, and again, another accountability factor.
But do you put people in groups like everybody is 65 and older, or 25 to 40, or how do you work that out?
We don't categorize by age. We our groups end up based on need, really,
okay,
and interest. So, for example, if you're interested in some flexibility programs, then we might encourage you to go to a stretch and relax class. And in that group, there might be a broad range of ages, but those people are all interested in the same thing.
Well, I tell you, when I watch the evening news tonight, I'm going to be doing this. You've inspired me. Thank you so much
for
coming, both of you.
Yes, ma'am.
And thank you for the help that you give people who really need it. very badly, I'm sure, your outreach. Thank you so much. From our Life Center, Kendra Garrett and Dane Smith. And if you're ready, let's get busy and get well and strong and healthy and put down the cigarettes. And we'll see you next time.